Ever since the 60s, humanity set its eyes onto the colonisation of Mars, and rightly so. After accomplishing the greatest achievement of mankind in setting foot on our moon, it is only natural to want to explore and set a flag down on our next immediate neighbour. Except this time, we want to go beyond a futile round trip that lacks any real objective other than just being able to say we once went there. This time, we want to establish an outpost and have a few select pioneers experience life on the red planet for an extended period of time. But how exactly do we go about doing that? And not only that, but how do we develop an affordable, reliable, and fully reusable transportation system that takes humanity to orbit the moon, Mars, and beyond? It's hardly surprising that we, as a species, are already making preparations to set foot on Mars. Since the 60s, we have sent numerous satellites to map out the terrain, find out more about Mars's climate and atmosphere, and just generally expand our knowledge so that we know exactly what we're dealing with. However, that hasn't come without failure. In fact, about 1 in every 2 spacecraft sent to Mars fails, which is partly due to the fact that landing on Mars is an engineer's nightmare. Both that and the fact that Mars is a graveyard full of landers and rovers that fail to make a descent soft enough to land hardly motivates engineers to attempt another mission. This, coupled with the 26-month waiting time for each launch window and the lack of funding, seriously hinders the rate at which we can learn about Mars. Now, while it is often made out to seem as though Mars is entirely within our grasp in the media and such, we aren't actually technologically capable of colonising Mars at this very instant, even if we had unlimited funding. Even if, say, you were the richest man alive and you had, for all intents and purposes, infinite money, no matter how much you wanted, that money is no use in funding a ticket to Mars, as no amount of money can buy a ticket to Mars, as of right now. Aside from the not-so-minor inconveniences that come with attempting to colonise Mars, such as providing radiation shielding for your passengers, the huge differences in gravity and its effect on the passengers and so on, that are yet to be definitively solved, there are still a few immediate steps that we must take in order to make the shipping of cargo and crew to Mars feasible, such that it is both highly reliable and carried out without spending excessive amounts of money in the process. Any process that requires excessive amounts of money to fund and sustain, money that you most certainly don't have, is a process that is almost always doomed to fail, which is why we must first take the steps to make our interplanetary transport system as economical and sustainable as humanly possible. The first step of which is the development of reusable rockets. Reusability is absolutely essential to make Mars voyages large enough to create a self-sustaining city on the surface. Don't get me wrong, full reusability is no easy task, particularly for interplanetary travel as opposed to just an orbital return. It's probably about the most difficult element to perfect out of all the aspects I'm about to discuss, but it does make a lot of sense to make strides for it. There is a simple reason why all modes of transport and all vehicles are not single use. It is not economical to be widely used among the population, and anyways, if it's within the realms of possibility, why wouldn't you strive to make a given vehicle reusable in the first place? It's in everyone's best interest, it's saving you and your customers far too much money to simply be overlooked and avoided. Can you imagine if after every flight airplanes were just discarded and thrown to the side? Almost all of a rocket's weight is fuel, and almost all of that fuel was used up within the first few minutes after launch, and that's only to get you to low Earth orbit, so no higher than an altitude of about 2000 kilometers or about 1200 miles, and then most of the rocket is designed to fall back to Earth and burn up in the atmosphere. It's like throwing away a new car and deciding to buy a new one after only driving it until it has run out of petrol, and in the not so distant future, single-use rockets will seem as absurd as doing something such as that. The end goal with reusable rockets, at least for now, is a rocket whose first and second stage can easily be recovered from re-entry and can be almost immediately refueled, ready for its next launch, all within a maximum time of 24 hours, which is not without some relatively quick inspections and refurbishments of the vehicle as you would do with airplanes. Ideally, a rocket of this type should be made to withstand upwards of 25 to 30 years of service, with only minor replacement of parts. In terms of Mars, this translates to 12 to 15 journeys during all of the launch windows over the course of its lifetime. The fundamental idea and aim of reusability is obviously to drastically cut the costs of a launch system, such that the main thing you are paying for, once you've built each component of the rocket, is the refueling, which is incredibly cheap compared to the typical cost per launch that runs in the hundreds of millions. In a perfect world, the cost of propellant is responsible for most of the expenses of maintaining the interplanetary transport system, but in reality, a good chunk of it is going to be maintenance. I'll explain the cost of this whole operation in more detail a bit later on in the episode. As I've mentioned, the vast majority of a rocket's fuel is used up in getting the rocket to orbit, which is why it is a great idea and frankly imperative that our interplanetary transport system includes a stage in which we refuel in orbit. This is the second step that we must take in enabling the success of this system. Refueling in orbit is absolutely essential, because if you don't do that, then your rocket has to transport extra reserves of propellant to be used just to get you to Mars, which is to be avoided at all costs, as this sets off a vicious fuel to mass ratio. The more propellant that your rocket carries, the greater its total weight. The greater its total weight, the more energy you must expend to escape Earth's gravity well, meaning more fuel is needed and so on. And so this mass ratio can very quickly spiral exponentially out of control. This all comes down to the rocket equation, and a few interesting things come out of it. It turns out that the delta V needed to escape Earth's gravity well to low Earth orbit is also approximately equal to that required from low Earth orbit to the surface of Mars. On top of this, all destinations between low Earth orbit and the Moon are but a fraction of the delta V required to just reach low Earth orbit from Earth's surface in the first place. That really puts things into perspective. Escaping Earth's gravitational pull with a payload sufficient enough to support your mission is one of the hardest aspects of space exploration. Now, a lot of what I've just discussed are the main goals of SpaceX, and some of which have already been achieved by them. In December of 2015, SpaceX managed to pull off the first ever landing of an orbital rocket's first stage after transporting 11 commercial satellites to low Earth orbit with their Falcon 9. And not 4 months later, another of SpaceX's Falcon 9 first stage was the first to land on their ocean platform as part of a cargo resupply mission to the International Space Station. They have now done this 51 times at the time of writing. While this is only the first stage being recovered and reused, which is very difficult in and of itself, it is making great strides in the right direction for full reusability. This is all in an effort for their ultimate goal of colonising Mars. SpaceX's current concept of their interplanetary transport system fundamentally consists of three fully reusable vehicles: SpaceX's Super Heavy booster, the Starship spaceship, both of which are collectively referred to as Starship also, a tidbit confusing I know, as well as a propellant tanker craft for in-orbit refueling. This serves as a two-stage to orbit launch system, where Starship acts as a second stage vehicle, allowing for the transportation of passengers or cargo to orbit, planetary destinations and beyond, but can also be used on its own for missions that don't require the need of any booster. To give you an idea of just how powerful Starship is, we can compare it to the Saturn V rocket. Due to the choice of the more energetic liquid-oxygen-liquid-methane propellant combination, which I'll discuss in more detail a tidbit later on in the episode, Starship can outperform the Saturn V by a factor of 4.1 on the mass delivered to low Earth orbit. It is even estimated to outperform the Saturn V by a factor of 3.6 on the thrust at liftoff. Also, it's important to note that Starship isn't restricted to just being used for the colonisation of Mars, but rather is suitable for the exploration of anywhere in the solar system, either robotically or with a crew on board. At the time of writing, NASA has just announced that they have picked SpaceX's Starship lunar lander concept for their Artemis space program, a program which plans to take humans back to the moon by 2024. But how does SpaceX plan to do all this? The idea is as follows. For any one trip to Mars during a launch window, Starship launches with the most thrust any rocket has ever produced. Once the desired altitude in low Earth orbit is attained, the booster separates from the second stage and subsequently performs a propulsive return to its launch site within 20 minutes of launch, perfectly placing itself for its next launch, where a propellant tanker can be placed upon the very same booster, all within a matter of hours. The booster with tanker is then launched and makes a rendezvous with Starship to refuel in orbit. Think of the tanker as a sort of portable petrol station that comes to Starship on its own. And, as you can see, its design is almost identical to the Starship, the main difference being that the unpressurized and pressurized cargo areas are filled to the brim with propellant and perhaps some cargo as well. The tanker then returns back to Earth after the refueling has taken place. It will take several tanker trips, anywhere from 3 to 5 times, to fully fuel Starship for its journey to Mars, a journey which is just the first one of many for this spaceship. And once all set, Starship departs for Mars. After a few launch windows from the initial Starship launch, you'd probably want to increase the number of spaceships sent, eventually enough for an entire fleet. The more you send, the greater the rate of expansion of the colony and the more you're populating Mars. Starship's impressive thrust can reduce the travel time to as little as just a 4-month journey on average, which when you think about it isn't all that grueling for the passengers when compared to sailing voyages back in the day that would last for 6 months or more. This becomes even more manageable when you consider that this travel time can be reduced to as little as a 30 days journey in the slightly more distant future. The short travel time is another essential aspect of the success of the system, as you want your passengers to be exposed to as little radiation as possible while in space. The same can be said for the lack of gravity. Once Starship reaches Mars, it can make use of its propulsive landing to land on the surface of Mars. The refinement of their propulsive landing techniques is what separates SpaceX from other competitors. Propulsive landing is the way to go, as its versatility allows it to be used in every environment. Parachutes or any other sort of landing technique isn't going to be much use on places like the Moon with its non-existent atmosphere. Now on the surface of Mars, this brings us to our third and final step that we must take in order to make an interplanetary transport system feasible: in-situ propellant production on Mars. While it's entirely within the realms of possibility to make round trips to the Moon without the need of any refueling at any point on the lunar surface, Mars is a completely different ballgame. Refueling on Mars is necessary, as otherwise you're just abandoning spaceship after spaceship on the surface and Mars just becomes this graveyard full of them. So a lot of thought has to go into choosing the right propellant to achieve this. We really only have to choose from three main options: kerosene, liquid hydrogen and liquid methane, which can be referred to as methalox. While each has their own pros and cons, it becomes clear that methane is the most suitable option. Rocket-grade kerosene, while it allows for a smaller size of vehicle, is a highly refined form of kerosene, similar to jet fuel, and so is quite expensive. Even if it could be easily produced on Mars, which is near impossible as there's no oil present, its propellant transfer isn't ideal, and its reusability potential isn't ideal either. Hydrogen is a little more promising though. While it has the greatest specific impulse of any known rocket fuel, it is even more expensive than kerosene. It wouldn't be much of a challenge to produce on Mars as you can just make use of electrolysis, but it does require a lot of energy to store liquid hydrogen at a low enough temperature to keep it from boiling off, which is pretty much at absolute zero. It becomes obvious that methane really just hits all the marks. Methane is ubiquitous across the solar system. There is methane ice in comets, it's abundant in Titan's thick atmosphere and even its ocean, the gas giants are filled with it, but most importantly, it is able to be widely produced cheaply on Mars by making use of electrolysis and the Sabatier process. The energy required to operate the propellant plant will largely come from a very large array of solar panels. Mars is ideal for the production of methane and oxygen. There are 5 million cubic kilometers of ice and 25 trillion tons of carbon dioxide, so there definitely is no shortage of reactants. Now let's talk about the costs and expenses of this entire operation. It is surprisingly only estimated to cost SpaceX around $230 million to fabricate the booster, $130 million for the tanker, and $200 million for the spaceship. When you think about it, paying a little over half of a billion for a fully reusable launch system is really getting bang for your buck. The interplanetary transport system is conceptualized to be fully reusable with 1,000 uses per booster, 100 uses per tanker, and as I've mentioned, at least 12 round trips to Mars with each starship over a period of at least 25 years. When it's put like that, half of a billion really doesn't seem like an awful lot, particularly over that time frame, and especially when you consider that it typically costs over a billion for rockets like the Saturn V to launch just once. And in comparison, the expenses for propellant and maintenance are dirt cheap and practically nothing compared to what NASA typically pays for each launch. One of SpaceX's key philosophies, among others, is allowing the transportation of passengers and cargo to celestial bodies in the solar system to be as cheap as possible. This is why SpaceX are making it a large priority to reduce the price of a ticket to Mars. They want to make it affordable to anyone who wants to go. It's about this intersection of people who not only have the money to go, but also want to go. The unification of these two types of people must be carried out by showing that Mars is somewhere you'd want to go, and by making it affordable to the average person, and not just a luxury accessible to the top 1% of the population. It is a common misconception that this technology, or just technology in general, will automatically progress and improve. This isn't the case at all. There is such a thing as technological stagnation, where technology doesn't progress any further and is forgotten and may even degrade at a point. Just look at the world's greatest civilizations, like ancient Egypt, and how they were able to build the pyramids and now they have forgotten how to do that. The Romans with their tremendous aqueducts, they forgot how to do it. It is so important to appreciate that space exploration isn't inevitable. It will take a lot of hard work and effort by a lot of people to make humanity a multi-planetary species. It is important to have a future that is inspiring and appealing. You want something that gets you up in the morning, and becoming a multi-planetary species and some of us escaping Earth and being among the stars and heavens does exactly this. Imagine bright megacities on Mars, a lunar colony able to be seen at night, a populated fleet of airships in the Venetian clouds, outposts dotted across the entire solar system. This is what an interplanetary transport system allows us to do, and it makes for a very promising future. Comment down below your thoughts on developing an interplanetary transport system for all of humanity. Make sure you subscribe for more content on astronomy and futurism. If you enjoyed this video, check out my most recent video on the colonization of Mars, a previous video, or perhaps my playlist on black holes. Thank you so much for watching. Have a nice day.